talking a little bit about my work on leprosy and tuberculosis in Portugal, and I'm sorry I will read my presentation, so I will keep on time. Leprosy and tuberculosis are mycobacterial chronic infections with relatively long incubation periods, both transmitted between humans. Leprosy is primarily a disease of the nerves and skin caused by the Mycobacterium leprae, while TB is caused by bacilli from the Mycobacterium tuberculosis complex, which can infect any organ or body system, although 70 to 80% of the cases are from pulmonary TB. Although leprosy and tuberculosis are curable with antibiotic therapy since the 1940s, the World Health Organization eradication targets have been seriously compromised over the last decades, due mainly to antibiotic resistance, poverty, and in the case of tuberculosis, HIV co-infection. The most recent released global statistics reveals around 200,000 new cases of leprosy and an impressive number of more than 6 million notified cases of TB worldwide. This means that there is much epidemiological, social, and political work to be done in the future, and we, archaeologists and anthropologists, may have a role in this, namely by unveiling the evolution and history of these diseases and by clarifying their biological and socio-cultural impacts on human populations over time. We know that both diseases have a long history in common with humans, with the oldest paleopathological evidence of leprosy found in India and of TB in Israel. In Europe, the most ancient cases were found respectively in Italy, 2,500 years BP, and Hungary, 7,000 years BP. So the aim of this presentation is to provide an overview of skeletal evidence of leprosy and TB in Portugal. Our starting point was the Portuguese bioarchaeological database recently compiled by our research group staff from published and unpublished data produced over the last 27 years in Portugal. Currently, this database comprises a minimal number of approximately 9,000 individuals unearthed from around 200 Portuguese archaeological sites and covering a time span of around 7,000 years. When data is stratified by inhumation type, the medieval period shows the highest share of primary inhumations, while ossuaries predominate in Neolithic and modern contexts. Concerning tuberculosis, we searched the database not only for the word tuberculosis, but also for descriptions of skeletal changes commonly associated to this disease. This group of lesions are well known, but I will show some of them, namely destructive changes both on the vertebral column and on extravertebral locations, such as the hip and knee joints, represented in B and A, rib and endocranial lesions, represented in C and D, and finally hypertrophic osteoarthropathy, represented in the figure E. As this graph shows, rib and endocranial lesions were the most prevalent ones, followed by vertebral destruction. However, it is important to stress out that except for tuberculosis vertebral destruction, also known as POTS disease, the remaining lesions are compatible with a TB diagnosis, but not exclusive of this infection, and as such, their differential diagnosis is fundamental. The paleopathological diagnosis of TB is tricky and is always a step-by-step procedure, considering parameters such as the topography and typology of lesions, their radiological appearance and clinical significance, the biological profile of the individual, and the archaeological and funerary context. Unfortunately, a final diagnosis is not always possible. Overall, 81 suspected cases of TB were found in our database. The temporal distribution shows that the majority belongs to the high and late medieval and modern periods, and there is no prehistoric evidence of TB in the Portuguese territory. All these suspected cases are being reanalyzed, and some of them being subject to radiocarbon dating, chemical and genetic analysis. Despite the relatively high number of suspected TB cases, only two of these have the required set of lesions to be considered probable cases of the disease. One skeleton came from the monastery of Flor de Rosa in Crato, and another one from the city of Castelo Branco. I only have time to highlight our most representative case of TB, found in 2004 in the São Miguel Church at Castelo Branco City. Historical sources mention the existence of this Christian temple since the 13th century, and that the associated necropolis was used until 1818. The skeleton number 4, a known adult with 12 years old, was exhumed from grave 8, which is one of the 20 anthropomorphic rock tombs existent in the East Churchyard Square. The pathological changes were noticed during the fieldwork, and later the laboratorial microscopic inspection and radiological study revealed a severe kyphosis and correlated thoracic deformities. The spine presented the most striking lesions, namely a gibbous deformity, which is characterized by a sharply angular kyphosis as the result of vertebral collapse and fusion at multiple levels. Also of note was a well-defined sinus tract for pus draining observed on the body of the ninth, the thoracic vertebra. Additionally, bilateral destructive and proliferative lesions were found on middle and lower ribs. So, a diagnosis of vertebral tuberculosis or Pott's disease is the most reliable option for this case, and if we consider all the above mentioned skeletal lesions. From the differential diagnosis were excluded several known infectious and infectious conditions such as trauma, neoplasms or brucellosis. So under the scope of an international collaborative research project on ancient DNA, bone samples of this individual were PCR screened for part of the genomic element IS6110. And the results were unfortunately negative. However, this does not mean that the individual was not infected with tuberculosis. Hopefully, whole genome sequencing techniques will provide positive results soon. Considering leprosy, I would like to remember that the skeletal involvement includes cranial and postcranial lesions, and currently the paleopathological diagnosis is based on the presence of specific rhinomaxillary lesions, usually characterized by destructive remodeling and or osteolytic activity. The most relevant postcranial skeletal changes for the diagnosis of leprosy are concentric atrophy and acroosteolysis of the tubular bones of the hands and feet. Our database reveals the existence of 8 skeletons affected by leprosy. The oldest case lived during the 4th, 5th centuries AD and was found in the city of Santarém. Interestingly, it is the only leprosy case found in a regular cemetery. The medieval leprosary of this city was only established many years later. The Beja Leprosarium necropolis retrieved 5 leprosy cases. And finally, I would like to present a few details regarding the Lagos Leprosarium that was excavated in 2009 by the company Drias Archaeologia, and I was one of the anthropologists of the team. A Lagos map from the 16th century shows the leprosarium exact location outside the defensive city walls, And historical sources reveal that in the end of the 15th century, the residents of Lagos began to pay a tax for the leprosarium construction, and this was hospital was in function until the 17th century, when geopolitical events motivated the renewal of the city walls, imposing the demolition of several buildings. Some of these buildings, including evidence of their demolition in the 17th century, were found during the excavation, as well as a previously unknown cemetery related to the leprosarium. Two of the 11 skeletons found, of the skeletons found have leprosy-related changes, and I would like to show you some of the most striking lesions present on the individual number 5, an adult woman. Extensive rhinomaxillary changes, typically occurring in advanced cases of lepromatous leprosy, were present, as well as postcranial lesions, namely on hands, phalanges, the elbows, with the right ulna showing an uncommon osteolytic lesion. Interestingly, amongst the 11 individuals, two other infectious diseases were diagnosed, namely trypanosomiasis and brucellosis, suggesting that the Lagos leprosarium was not exclusive to leprosy patients. Ancient DNA analyses are in progress, and we hope to present new findings in the near future regarding this material. So to conclude, currently we have solid evidence that leprosy existed in the Portuguese territory before the establishment of leprosarium in the 11th century and before the first written historical evidence of the disease in Portuguese medieval documents. Additionally, the two probable cases of TB are from the late medieval period, but under the scope of an ongoing research project, we are reanalyzing skeletons from 7 other sites, two of them dated from the early medieval period, to expand our knowledge regarding the historical path of this dreadful disease. So thank you very much for your attention.